I have to just explain the queen of teen thing. It doesn't mean that I'm a teen. Obviously, that hasn't been the case for quite some time. But it's one. It's kind of an award for authors who write for preteens and teenagers, and children and teenagers. The length and breadth of the country will vote for their favourite author. And I was very, very shocked and very honoured to be crowned the queen of teen with a very scary crown, about so big. And luckily, I've managed to leave that behind for a little while, so I haven't brought my crown with me. But thank you very, very much for the lovely welcome. I want to talk to you a little bit today about books and ideas and writing, maybe how I got started. I'm going to read you a chapter from Cherry Crush, my newest book, and talk to you a little bit about how I got the ideas for this, because this is actually the first in a series called The Chocolate Box Girls, and there will be five books in that series. So all of that to get through. Now, I want to make sure that you actually get to hear the things you're interested in hearing today, because if you've taken the trouble to come here, I want to make sure I'm saying the right kind of things to you. So if you have any questions or anything you would like to know more about, please save those up, and I'll get through as many of those as I can later on in the talk. So save your questions. I don't think you're going to be too shy, but just in case anybody feels a little bit nervous, I've brought a couple of prizes along, a couple of copies of a mini book called Cupcakes and Kisses, which will be given to the people asking the first really cool questions, and also some chocolate bars. Because that doesn't seem like a bad idea when the new book has a chocolate theme running through it, so I kind of think we should keep the whole theme nice and sweet. So that's for later on. I think I'm going to get one question out of the way right now. It's probably the thing I get asked the most often wherever I go meeting readers. And it really comes from kids exactly like you who are very curious to know what I was like back when I was your age and maybe what my favourite thing at school had been. And it's really people trying to work out what kind of interest you might have when you then go on to be a published author. So a fair enough question, really. And I think, if I was going to make you guess what my favourite thing at school had been, you'd probably imagine it would be literacy or English, and that would be a great guess, but it wouldn't quite be right. Because I liked all the bits of the English lesson where the teacher would say something like, write a story, free choice, anything you like. That was brilliant. But all the bits to do with spelling, grammar, and rules, not quite so exciting. So English I liked, but it wasn't my favourite thing. And you have heard that I'm very, very interested in art, and I ended up going to art college. I trained to be an illustrator, but art wasn't my favourite thing at school either, because I think this is very, very different in your school. I can see, just looking around, that you are a very creative school, but at high school I actually had an art teacher from just about the time of the dinosaurs, and his favourite thing was to get you to do endless still life drawings of cobwebby old wine bottles, which was not fun. So I loved art, but not at school. And thinking really hard to come up with a truthful answer to that question, I realised with a sinking feeling that my favourite thing at school hadn't actually been on the timetable to begin with. And that's a little bit frightening to admit to, particularly when we have teachers in the room. I'm just going to kind of pretend that they're not there, because I'm interested to know whether any of you have the same interest. My favourite thing at school was actually daydreaming. Is there anyone here who likes to daydream? Yes. Okay, leave your hand pointing upwards, please, if you've ever been in trouble for daydreaming. Very interesting. Okay, hands down. Very interesting. I love to do this survey because it always has quite interesting results. Now, the people at the front who were very polite and didn't have a good scan to see what was going on behind you, a lot of those hands actually went higher, because if you're foolish enough to daydream in school time, and I have better say right now, it's a really, really bad idea. You must never do it. I didn't tell you it was okay, but you know, generally it's going to get you into trouble. If you daydream at school, it's going to get you into trouble. But very occasionally, you do come across the very rare species, a very skilled and talented daydreamer, somebody who manages to daydream and not get caught. And I hate to point it out to the teachers, but there are a few of them here present. And I'm not going to actually point at anybody. Hopefully the teachers weren't looking too closely, but it can be done. And one of my earliest ambitions, if you like, was to work out how you could daydream and not get into trouble. Because my reports would come home and they always said things like, Cathy could do well, but she dreams too much. Not the kind of school report that goes down very well at home. So I really wanted to see if I could work out how to avoid getting caught. And eventually, I came up with three foolproof tips on how to daydream and get away with it. So lots of practice. It became my first proper skill, if you like. And normally, at this point, because I know your teachers really want me here to pass on lots of very valuable educational advice to you, that would normally be where I would begin, passing on the daydreaming tips. But I'm not quite sure if that's going to work. There might be a few slightly uncomfortable looks coming my direction from the teachers. And not just that, it's not going to help you if I tell you the tips for daydreaming while your teachers are listening. They're going to know exactly what you're doing. So I think we need a different plan. We need a backup. My idea would be that you can email me instead through any of the links on the website, cathycassidy.com. You can say, you were at my school today, please could I have the daydreaming tips? And as soon as I'm back from my tour, or possibly before, if I can get an internet connection, I will pass those on. Teachers need not apply. Okay? Just the young people. And I'm not actually telling you this to wind the teachers up, although it might be working, or to encourage you to Skype, because I genuinely believe that daydreaming is something we all should do a little bit more of. Can you imagine how amazing it would be if daydreaming wasn't illegal in school? If it was encouraged? If a whole special daydreaming classroom existed in every school the length and breadth of the country and beyond? And you were allowed to go into that classroom, maybe your feet would just sink into soft, thick carpet, there might be some nice wafty music, you'd sit back on beanbags and cushions. And your teacher, because I think you're still going to need a teacher even for a daydreaming lesson, would come in on a day like this with trays of fruit smoothies, chocolate brownies, whatever it takes to get you in the perfect frame of mind for daydreaming. And in that lesson, all you really have to do is switch off the front part of your mind, the bit that deals with all the logical everyday stuff, because that's great, but you don't need it all of the time. And when you pull the plugs out on all of that, that's when the really exciting stuff begins to happen. Random, unexpected, imaginative, creative ideas get the chance to come forward. And I guarantee that after a couple of daydreaming lessons, you might come up with a fantastic idea for a story, for a poem, for a song lyric, perhaps a piece of music, a painting, a sculpture, a dress design, even just a recipe for the best chocolate fudge cake ever created. But daydreaming time is never wasted time. It's a hotline to your imagination. And maybe it really should be on that timetable, but perhaps the teachers would need to call it something a little bit different. Perhaps something like creative visualization. And I reckon it could up the grades right across the curriculum, trust me. And I know it's not a waste of time, because these days I get paid to do it. That's actually what an author is doing for a living. You're pulling the daydream from your imagination and pinning it down on paper. And if you're lucky enough to be a published author, you then get to share your daydream with readers all around the world. And that's the most amazing feeling. And when I get emails and letters from readers saying things like, I felt like I was in the story, you know that they can see that daydream just as vividly as you could. So I know that you need to plan your stories at school, beginning, middle, and end. You might need to profile your characters. Don't stop doing that, because that's fantastic. But if you can get the daydreaming thing working too, that is what will help your stories to really come to life. And it's an amazing way of turning an idea or a piece of inspiration into a story. So it's not where the ideas come from, it's what you do with them. Putting through that whole daydreaming process is what can turn them into a story. So we'll maybe talk a little bit more about ideas later on, because I'm going to show you a slide of how I actually work now that I'm a published author. This is a picture of my writing shed. I live in the middle of nowhere in the Scottish countryside, which sounds idyllic for any writer really, except that I have two teenage children. My daughter is a drummer, my son plays the guitar, all their friends are in bands. It's a very noisy house to be in. So I've had to have a little shed in the garden with no phone line, no internet, and no teenagers kind of stomping through. And this is where I like to go to write. I like peace and quiet, just me and my laptop, and some of my very favourite things around me. And sometimes readers will come as well and visit and interview and ask questions and offer feedback and inspiration and ideas. And that is brilliant. Another place that I really like to work on ideas is the teepee. I actually have a teepee in my garden. This is an advantage of living in the countryside and having a big garden. When I sold my first book, Dizzy, Dizzy is a book with a little bit of a festival theme. It has some teepees in it, and we were given a paycheck, or I was given some money for the book, and didn't really know what to buy or what to spend, but wanted to do something that would, you know, kind of make it very special. And my husband said, "Do you think you could get a teepee?" Wanted a teepee ever since he was a little boy, so we got a real live big teepee, and it's possibly the best daydreaming space in the world. It's